Joe Biden wins on Election Day, he could be tasked with bringing our economy out of a depression. But who is advising him and what specific policies are they crafting remains a complete secret.
As the New York Times reports, Joe Biden is seeking input from more than 100 left-leaning economists and other researchers, but there is little clarity on who actually has real influence. The only publicly named three economists who are advising Biden are two former chief White House economists and the top economist for Hillary Clinton's transition team in 2016. Joining us with his theories on what the Biden economic policy is going to look like is Jacobin editor-at-large David Sirota. Great to see you, sir.
Good to see you guys.
Good to see you, David.
What did you make of just like the idea of secrecy around who is actually advising Joe Biden?
I think it has to do with what happened a few months ago, a few weeks ago, which was that two of his advisors leaked out. One was Larry Summers, a controversial figure, a guy who's seen as fairly aligned with the ideology of Wall Street. And then another story came out saying that Rahm Emanuel, the former Chicago mayor, former Obama chief of staff, is also advising Joe Biden. And, you know, those are two not such encouraging names to be on a list advising Joe Biden. They're people who aren't all that well liked. I mean, Rahm Emanuel left office in disgrace as Chicago mayor after a situation where his administration had essentially suppressed the video of a police murder of a teenager. So the idea that Joe Biden is being advised by these Democratic Party dinosaurs, controversial ones, I think it came out, people didn't like it, and now the Biden campaign is sort of like, hey, you know what, here's our solution. We're just not going to tell anybody anything about who is advising the potential next president of the United States.
They're going to put the economic advisor list in the basement,
yeah,
along with Joe.
I mean, David, what really caught our eyes, the New York Times reporter who even broke this story, he revealed one of his biggest qualms, Jim Tankersley. Let's put his tweet up on the screen. One of the things that it really matters is that the Biden campaign telling their advisors they can't disclose their role allows those people to go on TV without identifying themselves as part of the Biden team. And so, I mean, look, what we do here on this show, like when you were working for the Bernie campaign, is we're like, hey, this guy works for the Bernie campaign. So the viewers can know. And same with any other advisor to a candidate. This is a real disservice that the media is also being complicit in.
Yeah, and full disclosure, I am not a Joe Biden economic advisor.
Thank you for clearing that up. Appreciate that.
Yeah, look, I that's a really good point, and it's really problematic. We need to know if people are in an official role, and let's be very clear, like there's an official role and there's sort of unofficial, people talk to each other all
right.
the time, but if there is an actual official council of economic advisors advising Joe Biden, and those people are not telling media folk that they're talking to that, hey, I am literally on the official council advising Joe Biden, then yeah, it's a situation where there is advice being put out into the media that doesn't allow the audience to know what the actual affiliation is. Now, I also think this. This is kind of a gray area where, you know, what is an official advisor? What's not an official advisor?
Right.
If you talk to a candidate, are you an advisor? Are you, you know, what really are you? But I think that to go back to the key point here is that if there is an official policy by the Biden campaign that the Biden campaign will not disclose the people who are helping build the platform of potentially the next president of the United States, it's the policy at the center of this that really is the problem. The fact that they would go out of their way to create that policy, that really is problematic.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and what do we know about that policy? Because we got all these like fawning reports that he was going to be the next FDR. We haven't seen really the policy to back that up at this point. So what do we know?
Well, look, I think that he's got a pretty strong policy when it comes to labor rights, workplace rights, and the like. You know, he said he's for a higher minimum wage. I mean, I could go down the list of basic Democratic priorities that Joe Biden has rhetorically said he supports and that are on his website saying that he supports. I mean, to me, the question is not necessarily how many white papers he puts out saying he'll be for this or that. The real question, which is unanswerable, is, and we've talked about this before, is what kind of president would Joe Biden be? Would he be the kind of president who he was Senator Biden, And Senator Biden was a guy who was constantly juxtaposing himself against the base of his party. Or has he changed and realized that this is a different kind of moment and that this really does require something different than a kind of a triangulating late 1990s politician? We're not going to know that necessarily through a set of white papers, and we're not going to know that until he's actually in office. I will say one other thing, that we will know a little bit more about it, about who is actually around him. That's actually what's disturbing about the story about secrecy is that if you wanted to get a better clue of who the Joe Biden would be as president, it's not the white papers, it's who's actually around him who would be implementing and shaping the policy.
Yeah, I think that's a
good point.
I mean, we would look at Bernie, for example, and she would have like Stephanie Kelton. So you're like, okay, I know kind of like what I'm going to be getting here. And that's actually why I think the Larry Summers leak was so important, was because everyone was like, whoa, like this. You know, when you hire Larry Summers and he's advising you, you get a very specific type of policy. And so their reaction to that has just been like, oh, no, nobody gets to know what we're all about. And that really is, I mean, I think that's the most troubling thing, because we can't even guess as to how he's going to respond to the worst economic crisis in history. And David, maybe all we can go off on is his record last time around with the Obama administration, right?
That's a very good point. And you're right. Personnel is policy. And if personnel is policy, then who the personnel is tells us a lot about where the candidate's actual focus and where their ideology really is. And if we don't have that, you're right, then we look back and ask what was Joe Biden doing in the Obama administration? One example of that. Joe Biden was one of the people pushing for cuts to Social Security when he was in the Obama administration, and by the way, before that. But there was a push to get a deal on Social Security to essentially cut some benefits, one of these quote-unquote grand bargains. There's a group of folks in the Congress right now starting to raise questions about, you know, they're raising alarms about the deficit and the debt. We can get into that. But the point is that when the next president gets into office, how they actually view what to do about spending and Social Security, that's going to be a huge, huge issue for the next president. And what we can only look at is Joe Biden's white papers on his website, which says, to be clear, that he wants to increase benefits for Social Security. We don't know who's advising him, but we also know that back in the Obama administration, he was pushing for some cuts for Social Security. So we don't really know where Joe Biden's going to be if he was to be president in that situation.
Yeah, that's actually a really key point, David, that I hadn't fully thought through, which is that you already see Republicans, even with their own guy in the White House, when it is very much in their political self-interest to spend more money and try to get more help in the hands of the American people, lots of concern now about the debt and the deficit, and we can't spend more money. It's like ideological and political for them. And we know what will happen if a Democrat is in the White House. Suddenly, the debt and the deficit will be the most urgent priority and concern, because that's always what happens. And so I think you're exactly right. There's a big question about how Joe Biden will stand up to that kind of pressure coming from the right.
And he's been somebody who has been on the floor of the Senate, somebody who has prided himself in the past on saying, I'm a Democrat who's willing to cut Social Security in the name of deficit reduction and the national debt. Now, again, maybe he has changed. Maybe he understands the moment that we're in, that on top of everything, reducing Social Security benefits right now would be a disaster. It is entirely possible that people evolve. They understand the new circumstances they are in. But we just can't really fully know. And if we are deprived of information about who is actually advising him and shaping the policy, then we're even more in the dark than perhaps we would be in a normal situation.
Yeah, I think that's well said.
Very key point.
David, thank you so much. Great to see you, sir.
Thanks, Dave.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
See you, man. Next on Rising, in New Mexico, Native Americans are about 10% of the population, but they have 55% of all coronavirus cases in the state. And the founder of Illuminative, she shares how the pandemic is affecting Native communities when Rising continues.